Happy day, and you are here in the sunshine. How's it feel? But the sun is here, and speaking of sunshine, we have wonderful artist with us today, and Judy Rush is with the curator, Eliza Ho, who discovered Judy at my home holiday. I love your commentary, Eliza, on the adjacent play, as Judy and Michael have playfully presented this beautiful work, they still remain independent of one another. And I thought, from your statement, I watched children play in the snow 2 days ago, and they were quite independent. Having a wonderful time doing snow angels, all the things you can do with the snow people. And they're looking at each other. How do you like this? How do you like that? The interplay in the dance is beautiful, and so is yours. I said to Judy, now I know in your commentary you say we can roll around in some of the wonderful works. Judy said, well, I didn't bring those, so I'm glad I didn't hop into one of those holes this morning. Beautiful. Well, Judy Rush, you are presently as an adjunct professor at Columbus College of Art and Design. And as you work with the students, what comes to your mind and heart?
Now you've got your own microphone.
That's a hard one because they're frustrating and delightful all in the same moment. So I think their inquisitive nature about the fiber itself and what the reaction of the fiber is, just the basic bare bone fiber.
And where did you study as you?
I went to UMass Textile Design, and
you want to tell? You hear that?
Textile Design at UMass and. Master's degree at Ohio State in art education. I work with Chuck Suri, which is interesting in that Chuck Suri was not my advisor, but a guy working at him was his advisor. So I work quite closely with Chuck. Now they call him Charles, but I call him Chuck. And we called him Chuck back then too. And then it's interesting because when Michael was in undergraduate school, he was working with Chuck Suri as well, and he refers to him as Chuck as well. So everybody in modern time calls him Charles for sure. He's a big name in art.
And as Judy, you came to know Eliza, how is it that you connected by what? You're discovering the work of Judy?
I discovered Judy through my husband. I remember one time that Judy came into my office. So we happened to have our offices in 400 West Ridge, you know, just 2 minutes down here, you know, in Franklinton. And I think my office, so my husband is an architect, and I studied artistry, and my graduate work was done at OSU, for artistry and modern art. And but then we have our own business, you know, doing a lot of restaurant designs and residential projects and things like that. And our office is at 400 West Ridge, and Judy's office in, you know, studio is at 400 West Ridge. And one time, my husband had some computer problem, and Judy, you know, graciously, you know, just very, you know, kindly came into my office to help out something, and that's how I came to know Judy as a person, not as an artist in the first place. But then, you know, as the conversation goes on, you know, of course we'll touch upon, you know, the stuff that we're passionate about. And slowly we kind of like discover Judy's artwork. And as the conversation goes, you know, a relationship grows, it's kind of like, it's sort of organically grow the relationship. And, you know, very recently, and Judy also mentor my children, my two children in the summer, you know, teaching them how to, you know, make ropes and how how to felt. So, you know, I feel it is, you know, relationship, something like that, that, you know, you start out with a small thing and then it kind of grow bigger and bigger and then you see more potential in it. And it's kind of like a nice metaphor of, you know, Judy's work, kind of like she expand her, you know, capacity and also the artistic sensibility, you know, through this exhibition as well.
Exciting, too exciting. And your husband is?
Oh, yes.
Uh-huh. Stand up. Architectural artist.
That's my daughter sitting next to me. She's pregnant.
Well, congratulations. Well, what would you like to say, Jenny, since Michael Halliday is not here, how would you talk about his work and you chime in, since you're the one who brought them together, or did they come to you?
Well, Michael and I were just kind of friends, studio buddies. We talk about art, go sit in the back of the 400 and by the railroad tracks, set up some chairs, and just sit and watch the trains come on, and talk art. We just kind of ramble on and on and on, and that's how pretty much how we just be friends, take a break during the middle of the day. And then we were on the same floor eventually, so that made it a little easier. And then I knew that Eliza was working with Michael in a lot of areas. And I liked the way she talked about his work. I just liked the influence of her words into what he was doing. Whether he responded to it or not was a different thing, but I certainly responded to her comments. So I went with Lisa. So, in all honesty, I think I've been able to this. I may not have been able to this true, but I think I did, so whatever. But it's really been an interesting working arrangement. Glass is very organized, very to the point, writes well, and I in none of those things. So I really appreciate that level of interest and experience and willingness to do that work in order to help us just get to doing artwork. And then she just put the show together. She took what we had, just put the show together. So I don't know how many of you have put a show together, but to do all the marketing, to do all the design of the show, to do all the interaction with the format that you're having the show in the format, in this case would be the Cultural Arts Center, that's a lot of work. It's a lot of work, it's a lot of brain work that, as an artist, I don't want to really delve into. I just want to go to the art park and leave all those words there, you know, for something else.
You know, so I want to say, too, really you danced with Mother Nature and had to cancel the opening. So now, you're with the Groundhogs on February 2nd.
Groundhogs,
yeah, for the opening.
Talk a little bit more about, you know, the curatorial process of this exhibition. My husband and I have always been a big fan of this space. You know, that architecturally, you know, we think it is one of the best arts gallery in Columbus. The ceiling height, you know, all the historical characters of the building, and also, you know, it's just the accessibility of this building. You know, it's open to all, and you know, it's open, you know, 6 days throughout the weekend. It's very welcoming. And I also like that it has the built-in audience, you know, of this building. You have classes going on all the time. The energy is just so much, you know. We love the variety of this building. And personally, when I, you know, I've always been, you know, I've been with as a good friend with Michael Halliday for, I would say, 6-7 years now. And I'm always a big fan of his work, you know, the artistic quality of it, and also his artistic process. From ideas to execution, I also collect some of his really small little sketches. It just gives me so much, you know, inspiration. And I'm a person who needs to connect dots. So I'm always attracted to ideas that are done in different disciplines, but then when they're brought to a different context or bring different mediums together, I like to see the synergy of it. So I think that's how I'm attracted to my holidays work and Judy's work, you know, they are different artistic media, you know, one is fire, you know, one is simply paint. And, you know, when you bring them together, there are a lot of surprising elements that comes out of that, you know, combination of work. So, you know, so we, I think in the summer when we, I think it's maybe like a little bit early when we submit for the, you know, proposal to use the art gallery here, we kind of like talk about, well, you know, how are we going to fill up the space? You know, that, you know, Julie's thought, well, you know, this small little, you know, creatures, you know, it might be really hard, you know, to this space. But then we think about Michael's work, you know, it's this oversized painting, you know, 72 by 72 inches. It will be a great, you know, a great kind of addition to this gallery. So we thought, well, maybe we can bring something interesting together. I think, you know, the whole idea is started out because of the big difference between Judy's work and Michael's work. Oh, one big and one small. How do we bring them together? And as we talk more and more, I think that it's really the sensibility that brings the two artists together. And also the process when they create, you know, like Judy was saying that, you know, there are a lot of conversations between Michael and, you know, Judy in their leisure time, you know. I think this is one of the things, you know, for artists and, you know, for architects, for designers as well. We work not at a certain hour, you know, our brain is always, you know, turning and turning. We are looking for inspiration all the time. I think that's the outcome of this show is really a lot of thinking and a lot of inspiration, and we don't necessarily have a very clear idea of what the outcome will look like. We just kind of like, you know, go as it develops. So, you know, when we were talking with, you know, the manager here, you know, Tom, and when we had a meeting with Jeff and Todd here, we suddenly realized that, you know, in that space, you know, as we walk in from the front, you know, that corridor space, in fact, there is a scaffolding or, you know, something from hanging from the ceiling that we can hang some work from, you know, from the top. And all of a sudden, you know, I make the connection. Well, Judy has a lot of bowls. And when you, you know, think about bowls, bowls are supposed to be sitting on something, you know, like that. But what if we actually hang it from the ceiling and turn it upside down and, you know, create that, you know, in a different angle and to create an installation of that? What would it be like? You know, so we are thinking from an experience, you know, point of view to see, you know, to think about, well, as a viewer who come in, as they walk through, you know, the space, what's the experience going to be like? So I think that's the kind of like change our perspective from the idea of how are we going to fill the gallery to a more experiential, you know, experience that we want to create, you know, in this gallery. So so that's, you know, part of the curatorial process.
Wonderful. Well, how about Judy walking us through this experience that you just beautifully described?
Does everybody get up and walk through the walls?
Want to go through the on the other side?
Also, just kind of feel what it feels like to be underneath that, okay?
Yeah.
And just adjust the way you feel underneath that.
And we'll do it just for a few minutes because we have to get
through the process in the room.
People called and have said, oh, they remind me of jellyfish. And it's pretty interesting because my son lives in LA. He has a season pass to the aquarium out there, so we spend a lot of time in the aquarium. And they have an excellent jellyfish display, so that's, people are referring to these as jellyfish. It's not a surprise to me because it's certainly in my awareness. But I'm interested in, as you're walking around these bowls and walking in them and walking around them and walking under them, I think each bowl kind of has its own personality, and I think there is a certain amount of energy actually coming off of those bowls, and each one has a little bit of different information in it. So if you kind of just sit with them for a minute, you can kind of experience the different energies inside the bowl and outside the bowls. Yeah, just like these three kids are doing.
I have a microphone here if anyone wants to comment.
That's the point. And when it's dark outside, you can see the light coming through.
Yeah,
the light side.
Yes,
Judy, I have a question.
How
do you make the round shapes?
I put them on a really giant. I know, but the yoga balls have bridges. I felt it some more to facilitate it.
So how do you get the two color process?
That, and so I used to cut it and sew it together. These are all seams.
Okay.
So I just sew it on there, so.
Okay.
Right, here's a good one.
Judy, do you dye the roving first?
So you don't have to decide the roving.
Yes, the roving is dyed.
Right?
No, no. I lay a layer of fiber, and then I lay another layer of fiber, and then I lay a third layer.
Okay.
So were you expecting it to be transparent or translucent?
I was trying to figure out what I could do and how I could manage a bit.
It's a beautiful metaphor as a society that different pieces of the fiber come together and then you create, you know, this kind of diverse.
Has leaves some material in it and it's been reflected. So that was something I was concerned about. But I kind of like it in the light. I like that. But there's other issues that are going on that I'm not going to tell you about that I was really concerned about. I had some very excellent advice on that.
Yeah, the other thing I found fascinating is that Judy's methodology, you know, or the method of making this fiber and mixing those colors. So typically we will understand abstract artists, you know, or abstract, you know, painter, they work in a very spontaneous way, right? It's not super calculated or, you know, have a drawing or that kind of stuff. Judy, you know, even though the work looks like very spontaneous and very expressionistic, but it's a lot of, you know, mathematical calculation and scientific, you know, mixture. You know, when I see that, you know, how many, like, oh, percentage of this color and, you know, all that kind of mixture, I see it on, you know, her wall. And then I just realized that, no, you know, these look like spontaneous artwork. Actually, it's a lot of calculation and, you know, a lot of methodology that goes into it.
You revealed she's good on computers.
Well, I maintain local area networks as a job for my health insurance, you know, so I know a lot about computers. Don't ask me to answer the phone. I can't do that very well. But I can fix your computer.
For your bowl there with the starscape in it.
This one?
Yeah, are those asterisks, whatever we want to call them, belted in, or are they painted after the fact?
No painting was done after the fact.
Okay, so this is
belted in. And so I pre-felt the stars, cut them out, so they made me the same, and then I felt them into the rest of the floor. And those stars, I went to Egypt a number of years ago with my sister, whose father-in-law is Egyptian, so we had the most fabulous tour. It was right after the accident at Hatshepsut's temple, and they killed all the German people, but they kept calling it an accident. There was nobody there. So we got into everything. Like, we didn't even stop to eat because we had so many opportunities available to us. And one of the things we got to do is we got to go into Nefertari's tomb. And it had just been opened, so that the painting was still in pretty good condition. And the whole top of the, clammy just thinking about it. The whole top of the ceiling were these stars, so that had a huge impact on me. And also, the goddess Isis was very predominant in these tombs, and that that some warring faction has decided to take on that monkey ear is really disturbing to me, you know. So, and this was before all this stuff was going on. So I'm here to bring back Isis back. Goddess of life, the goddess of love.
Is there any way to calculate how much time you spend doing?
Morning, Lisa. Are you going to share a bit about my holidays? And then maybe we want you to continue to tell us about this world surrounding us.
Okay.
Since Michael is not feeling well today, and I will be speaking from a perspective more from a viewer and, you know, a person who study arts, you know, and art history. And I think it's about a year or two ago, Michael people start to develop a vocabulary is very geometrical. So as you can see that on the left-hand side, which is on your right-hand side, you know, on that side of the wall, it is a series that he called the rectangle series. So the dominant feature of that series, of course, is, you know, the rectangle in the middle of the canvas, right? There was one painting that Julia and I kind of spent time of when talking about it. It was this year, not this year, but 2017, early that year. I think that month was the largest of women's protest in DC. And we were looking at Michael's painting, the one on the far, you know, the first one, the pink one, with the pink background, you know, with the white rectangle in there. So Julie started to ask me.
Certain paintings give me certain feelings and emotions with certain colors.
Yeah.
Can you explain the emotions and colors to me?
Yeah.
Because this has given me a lot of feelings.
That's great. That's what I want to hear. So I will share with you our conversation of that piece, you know, specifically the pink one. So, and Julie was talking about, well, what does it look like to you, the rectangle? And I was like, well, it looks like a door, you know. And then we were talking about, well, is it really a door, you know, that is it open in or is it opening out? And then we talked about, well, you know, it's a rectangle. It could be a window, you know, you look out or you look in, you know, things like that. But, you know, it's the pink colors, you know. The societal, you know, environment, you know, at that time that, you know, women feels empowered, you know, in that moment, you know, Julie obviously went to the DC, you know, the parade and the protest. So, you know, we strongly, you know, feel that, wow, you know, it really truly speak about, you know, the gentle but then a very assertive force, you know, that women comes together and is the pink color. That, you know, is nothing, you know, too violent, but then it opens up the world. I think that's the conversation that, you know, Julie and I were having, and, you know, Michael was more like you're listening to, you know. So Michael, as an artist, he is a very observant, you know, artist. He listens and he observes a lot, you know, and he just takes it on that in. And I haven't really had a conversation to ask him, oh, so when we talk about those stuff, you know, how did that affect your creative process? But and then he further develops, you know, I think the latest piece is the one, you know, with the brown, you know, the kind of the golden background, you know, this one. This is the latest one that he just recently completed. And then as we develop this show together, you know, what's in my mind that, well, how do I bring the two artists together? How do I make, you know, how do I facilitate the collaboration between the two artists? Because I think it is still very important that, you know, when we bring two artistic, very different artistic medium together, I want to make some connection, you know, for the viewer to understand and maybe opens up some other ways to look at their work. So the piece that's specifically created for this gallery, for this show, it is the one that's the blue pedestal. And then one day I was telling Michael, well, you know, I know that the cover art center has many, many pedestals, different shapes, different sizes, different height that, you know, store in the basement. Well, let's go look at that. Well, I kind of like, you know, reminds me of your rectangle. And then we, you know, the three of us went downstairs. We, you know, kind of studied through every single pedestal. Well, which one that works, you know, for the show that I can create that here. And then we picked two of them, and then I, you know, brought it back to Michael's studio and asked Michael to contemplate the two white pedestals, kind of like, you know, beaten on pedestal. Well, Michael, think about how is it related to your two-dimensional work. And then Michael just, you know, kind of like, just let it sit, you know, and look at that, develop some ideas and all that. And then one day he called us up, well, Julian and I said, come over to my studio and look at that. And this is the blue pedestal that he painted. So, I would encourage us, you know, all come to see here, you know, and kind of like walk around it. It's supposed to be, you know, that you walk around it and experience, you know, the pedestal. So I think, you know, this rectangle kind of like gives So when it comes to intimate pattern, so obviously your pattern will need to, you know, kind of like change because of the object, you know, it's a different thing, you know, you put it on the floor and paint. So I think, you know, it kind of like also represent, you know, his gestural, you know, paintbrush, you know, on this pedestal. And you can look at that and kind of develop her felt, you know, as the background of it. So, you know, through this piece, which we call I Felt You Paint, which is the title of the show, I think it kind of like solidified, you know, the essence of this show. You know, I want the two artists to be able to create collaboratively and kind of in response to each other's sensibility. So, you know, so Judy's, you know, piece felt here, and then we make a connection between the felt and the, you know, the rectangle here. So we put the rectangle series kind of on the wall to kind of make that, you know, visual association.
Wonderful.
You have anything you want to share with us, you know, how you create a felt and, you know, in response to
those? Oh, yeah, that's fine. So this painting was definitely my inspiration. This was hanging on the wall down the hallway.
Judy, do you want to come out and stand maybe near that blue pedestal? Oh, great. Wonderful.
So I didn't have the pedestal, and Michael was out of town, so I couldn't really go see it, but I had pictures of it. And I tend to like to work better with just the idea in my head that seems to work even better. Hold on just a minute. Anna, are you looking for Dad?
Yeah.
Call him, because I think he might have left. He's having a little emergency, not too big. So I just pretty much just started making this. These are made in panels of four, and then I put the panels together and felted them together. But these are really thin layers of felt again, and when you felt little really thin layers of felt, you give it some aggressive behavior. The holes in here open up, they become fragile, and I think that was the part that was so interesting about what was going on with this felt for me in particular. I never produced anything like this big, but the work that I usually produce is mostly poster size. And I gotta say, I really like this. I really like the randomness of it. Next, we have other proposals for other places, and I think I might just expand on this some more and just maybe cover walls, holes, or whatever. Because I really like making this, and I like the way it fills the space. But I also want to talk a little bit about Michael. When Eliza was talking about Michael a little bit, Michael's a very sensitive man. For those of you who know him, he's so sensitive. So people are talking about being able to feel the color and having a visceral response to his paintings. I think that's just Michael. He comes out with the most sensitive answers to some questions that are just below me. So, and this painting down here of Michael's, do you want to talk about that one? That's something that's near and dear to his heart. Can you talk about that one at all?
Yes. So, you know, as the curator for the show, so when I was talking with Michael, well, you know, which pieces to be included in the show, I kind of like talked with him, well, should we include this flat, you know, in the show? Because I don't necessarily see the connection in having this piece to fit in the show. But then Michael is very insistent about, well, he has to have this flat, you know, to in the show. And then I was like, okay, you know, we have to compromise that, you know, so I'm okay, you know, include this, you know, flat in the show. But then I wanted to be on its own, you know, on itself, on the wall. So that it gives it, you know, an independence, you know, presence, you know, to this piece of painting. I can't speak about, you know, Michael's political stance, you know, in relation to the Palestine flag, but, you know, he certainly is trying to, it's not planned. So a lot of time, you know, for artists, it's like, you know, they develop their vocabulary as they go. So he started out, so the first piece, you know, as you walk in the gallery, the one in the front gallery, that's the first in the rectangle series. And then he develops all these other rectangles, you know, through a period of like about 2 years. And so I think this one belongs to a later period of time, you know, in the series of the rectangle series. So, you know, he saw that, well, you know, it's a rectangle. Maybe, you know, he can actually, you know, bring in a flat, a more figurative, you know, a symbol, you know, to the expressionistic, you know, type of painting. So, you know, I hope, you know, in the reception day, that reception night, that Michael is here and then we can talk more about, you know, the political meaning of this piece.
Eliza, we've talked about the rectangle pieces, the rectangles being possibly windows, being possibly doors. These rectangles could also possibly each be flags.
Yes, exactly. Yes.
So symbols of some type of statement.
Mm-hmm. Right. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
I definitely think that's Michael's work. It's definitely symbolic of some kind of statement.
Mm-hmm. What kind of paint? I didn't.
He paints in acrylic.
And oil.
But
he
can
afford it.
That was his concern. He and I talked at great length the other day. We were just talking about the expense of using large canvases and trying to afford oils.
Right.
So most of these, I guess, were done in acrylic.
Or house paint.
Well, how about if we go back and sit down and you tell us more about your pieces, Judy?
Ooh, okay. I knew the woman who was hosting me. She's a friend of mine, but I did art the whole time I was there. I'd get up in the morning and I'd start making art and go to bed and I'd still make art. She thought I was going to tour the country and I was like, I'm coming here to make art away from all my distractions. But she's the one who turned me on to Felter. And she took me to a bunch of artist studios and other Felters and took me to a it was a felting, some sort of gestalt, I think it was, gestalt felting course that was like 4 years in the making. And at the end of the 4 years, you can become an art therapist, and their medium was felt. And they make all these crazy felting critters. What they do is they partially felt wool with a lot of soap. They don't really care about the soap amount. The amount of soap that you put into a felt. Soap acts as a lubricator, but the amount of soap that you put into it has an effect on the way it felts. So they don't care about that because they just get it really hot, really wet, felt it a little bit, throw the whole soapy wet thing in a dryer. And it comes out with all these different goofy kind of shapes. I don't have any of that right here. Well, this is probably a good example. This shape right in the middle of her body, this is an odd shape. And then we stitched on it, and then we put these parts and pieces together. She mostly just made heads, and then put other stick bodies on her or something. But I started putting felted bodies on it. She thought that was like, oh wow, what a novel idea to make the body out of felt. But I'm a quilter, that's how I got into this world. So I don't do a lot of hand stitching on my quilts. Quilts are all hand stitched. This takes a long time. My quilts like take a year for a single quilt. These, you know, I can do these in my leisure time. Sit in front of the computer and relax. Sit on my studio. It's a lot less intense as far as time involved and to completion. So that's how I learned how to felt. And she was also a student of this gestalt class for a little while, and it was too intense for her, so she dropped out. But we talk about all the implications of the beings that we're creating and what part of us is in that being. So we made all those kinds of connections, and that was pretty much fun. But I came back to Columbus, and part of my coursework for these students is to take them through all the different parts of fibrum and to get to fabric process. And they're all pretty interesting. I think it's like wildly entertaining, but they're a sweet day, a lot of morning. We take them through just exploring fibrum, and then we teach them how to weave and knit and spin yarn, and then dye all the yarn to print on fibrum, dye all the fabric. kind of the science around that a little bit for art students. And then the really interesting part that we can never get to, because all those other parts take so much time, is the finishing. Because all the properties and characteristics of any fiber carry through to the end product up until the point where the finishing gets put on. And then all the properties and characteristics can change. For instance, cotton is a very absorbent fabric. You can put a waterproof on there, and suddenly it becomes non-waterproof, changing completely the properties and characteristics of the fiber. That's wildly interesting to me. Just that I can do something that's without a hardener on here, this thing would just be flat. It had some structure to it, but not like nothing like this. So I can't wait to see where this goes. Yes, sir.
What type of hardener do you use?
I use a mixture of glycerin, just a very little bit of glycerin, in about a gallon of water to about maybe 2 cups of gel. So it's called BioGlass. So there's a hashtag.
Sir, you might have mentioned that I didn't hear it. Where do you teach?
CCAD, fashion design. That's true, that's what I do. I stand over it like press it together just to get the moisture and the soap into the fiber. But at that action of pressing really opens up the fiber and entangles them mechanically, so they can't come untangled. If you looked at a fiber of wool under a microscope, it would sort of look like the top of asparagus plant, you know, stalk that you eat. And when you add heat and moisture to that fiber, those cuticles are called opening up. And when you have it next to another fiber, like fiber, whose cuticles are opening up, those cuticles intertwine. And when they connect, they can no longer be separated. So it's permanent. So all these commercials that you're seeing these days for how to get felting out of your sweater, I don't know what that's about, because I can't get felting now. I work with it every day, right? So, yes, ma'am.
Do you have any control at all over the felting process?
Oh, yeah. I have a lot of control.
Well, that's what you're saying, like, if you get it wet, it just does its thing.
Well, no, you can see it's, I have designs in some of these. So I have a good amount of control over what happens. So like this bowl has all the stars in it again, and these, they're pre-felted, stick them into the space, and then by just gently pressing on them, it is a pressing, but it's an entangle at the same time, gently pressing on it, then I can get those to combine. But again, I use really, really, really hot water, because like just a few presses will felt it, but I have to wear gloves because it's too hot. Because it takes away a lot of the physical part of the work. In the giant felting bowls that'll be here at the opening, they're like this big around. And they're like they shrink 33% approximately. It can shrink a lot more than that, a lot less than that, depending on how much you felt it. But I mean, it's like 8 pounds, and then you add water to that, it gets to be at like 100 pounds. And I can flip it around, move it around if you're adding that much water. Well, I've learned how not to work that hard, so because I want to take some felting blocks. So over time, I've learned how not to do that, and so hopefully I can make the next one without so much physical work. But you add water to anything, and it's heavy. These are only 3 layers of wool. My felted bowls are 6 to 8 layers of wool. They get exponentially more absorbent, absorb more water. So these are easy to manage because they're little, they're lightweight. I can absorb the water from them easily using an absorbent towel and move along. But the bigger ones are the big bowls that you can get into.
So what happens if these get wet?
They have to be remolded. The gelatin hardener stays in, but it's really hard to get it out. But they have to just be remolded. So, as a matter of fact, I took some of these before the show and remolded them. This one right here. It didn't look like that. So I remolded it before the show.
Yes, this is Alice's comment. The palettes are so similar, but what's nice about this show, I think, is you have geometric square and then round. You know, it's just, you know, kind of an interesting situation. Yeah.
We talked about that too, the organic nature of my work and the square, hard edge nature of painting in general.
Right.
You know, and then Michael has geometric patterns in his things he's interested in exploring. So
that observation is coming from 3 amazing artists. Yes, let's start here. Your name is?
Art Vogel.
And Suzanne. Wonderful. So do you know each other?
Yeah. Sue and I used to be an art a couple of years ago. It was only 3 of us. And I credit that group for really giving me confidence. Growing. Before that, I was just a sniveling baby.
I don't think that's. I sort of understand your evolution to the big stuff, but I hope you never give up this little stuff that makes me.
Yeah. Oh, it makes me smile too. It's like, you know, and my son.
They have the little stuff.
My son, I think I mentioned, he lives in Los Angeles, so I don't get to see his kids very much. But I asked him if I could send his daughter a doll, you know, because I have to ask him because his view on the world is a little different than mine. And so he says to me, yeah, but you can't send any of the crazy one. It has to look like a normal doll, right? Right? Oh, wait, there's an end to this story. So now when I talk to my granddaughter on the phone, we don't just sit and talk, we play games, we take tours of what's going on in my neighborhood, or, you know, so what do you do with a two-year-old? You only have such limited attention span, so I want as much of her attention as I can get. And I take her on a tour of my doll. She laughs. She laughs at them. You know? So,
you were talking about to care for.
It's about a foot in the
you are caring for grandchildren with your art. How wonderful.
No, we all do that.
What a legacy.
All artists do that.
That's so, who we are. Judy, thank you. This was marvelous. Yes. And how it is that you came to know Judy is a real gift to us because didn't it just come together a work of art? Please give our best to Michael Halliday, and we'll see him the day of the groundhog, February 2nd, 6 to 8 here as we reschedule the opening. And we won't know whether we'll have six more weeks of winter or not. We won't even care. This will be so beautiful.
What choice do we have?
What choice?
Yeah.
Well, thank you.
We're very
grateful.